All right, welcome everybody watching at home to a Rising Tide video. As you know, I'm Matthew Ehret, a director of the Rising Tide Foundation, and with me here is Patrick Cyr, a classical painter in Montreal. Actually, we're not in Montreal, we're in Saint-Eustache.
It's suburb.
But
close to.
Patrick Cyr, and behind me here is our friend Assad, is one of the few renowned classical painters here in Quebec who's not only done something very special, which is why I've been working with him now for about 2 years as my instructor. But he is one of the few people who's been able to make a living as well as teach the lost art of Renaissance techniques in painting. So Patrick has agreed to just throw a few answers at us, and I have a few questions that I think a lot of the audience would like to know a bit more about.
My pleasure.
You have a very unique story. You didn't originally start off as an artist. You started off in a different, with a different identity and a different orientation, and somewhere along the way you chose to focus on the arts. Can you tell us a little bit about your story? How did this decision come about?
Okay, yeah, but first, when I was young, I was very motivated by the science, and especially astrophysics and all the astronomy particularly, because I am still an amateur astronomer. I always watch the sky as soon as I've got a chance. And so as a young guy, I was motivated to study the science. So I went to Polytechnic of Montreal. I did my Sciences Po in the program, the course of the education program. So I went to a Polytechnic for 1 year. So when I met the teaching of the classical drawing, I fell literally in love. So I quit the studying engineering, and I changed totally the path, you know, the path of my study. So since 1993, I studied fine art.
That's quite the leap. So you were actually in engineering.
Yeah.
And somewhere, what is it in classical painting that captured your soul to such an extent that you made such an amazing leap to go all the way out of engineering and just focus?
This is a good question. What I understand a few years ago of what happened is that it's the cognitive process. It's when you understand a scientific principle, the great scientific principle like gravitation or electromagnetism, and most of the cognition that needed to understand scientific principle is the same cognition to understand how to build a fine art piece. So it was kind of intellectual transposition. So for me, it's another way to do science, to paint like the great masters.
And that makes a lot of sense, because I mean, I myself have an art background, and I got to say, in the period that of only 2 or 3 years that I've been working with you, I found that there's a much more scientifically rigorous approach in construction, and I've had to, in a way, shed a lot of the bad habits that I was given in art school to just go in and express yourself. And since I've been working with you, I've discovered that there's an entire process, like building almost like a house, where you just can't start any old way. You have to
have
a
And
this would offend a lot of artists today, to the idea that there is a reason that has to govern your approach to beauty. How would you, do you find yourself in debates, or do you find yourself ever being criticized for your approach of trying to impose reason onto beauty?
This is very interesting what you say, because it's much more than a debate. It's a war. It's a cultural war, literally. Because there's a pressure out there for irrationality and chaos, kind of. But in fine art, it's totally the opposite of chaos. It's harmonia. And it's spiritual. For me, it's spiritual. And it's a great philosophical debate. It's reached the proportion of the purpose of the universe. Literally, the way that a society treat the cultural world, it will be the future. And people, most of the people nowadays, they don't grasp this kind of idea. Because the since the 50 last years, it's a total destruction, and I don't know if it's a good word in English, but derision. How do you say
derision?
Derision. Yeah, yeah. Destruction and derision. It's a kind of modus of the cultural world today. So when you bring fine art, it's in total opposition of that ideas. And people, they cannot grasp, unfortunately.
Do you find that you've had, I mean, you teach here, you have a studio, and you teach students. Do you have a lot of difficulty with new students coming in, realizing that they have to learn these principled scientific techniques before going into constructing paintings? Or do you find that there's an ease by which you're able to communicate and to bring people through that multi-level process where they can finally get to a stage where they're painting?
What I observe, it's not the process of the construction of a fine art piece. The difficulty of the students is in the perseverance, in the perseverance of the learning process.
Yeah.
They think, but few of them, they think it's impossible to learn in that level, but it's not true. You're not born with paintbrush, so it's a training process.
Yeah.
And nowadays there's a myth of the talent when you should be born with some kind of special things, and then you can have the highest ability to do things. Mm-hmm. But it's not true. It's a training process. And I sincerely believe that the real genius, you're not born with it.
Yes.
You are trained for it. And you have to find a will inside of you to reach that level.
So what do you think you could say? And I'm glad that you said that, because I completely believe that too. But what could you say to teachers who, obviously, not every student is going to exemplify an interest in something that, and I would say that interest is required if they're going to excel and improve and discover that they are good at whether it's painting or something else. But what could you say to what do teachers need to keep in mind when they're teaching a student who doesn't believe that they have the skill to improve in painting or something else? Because I'm sure a lot of teachers need to learn this lesson.
It's very hard, first of all, to find a system of training, and the teachers that accompany that kind of system of training that brings you to believe that you can do it. See, forget about you cannot. You have to teach. That's not you cannot. It's a struggle. And then you can overcome that struggle.
Overcome. Yep.
The struggle, right, to learn something. But as a teacher, sometimes I succeed to transmit it that you can overcome the struggle. Mm-hmm. But sometimes, unfortunately, it happened few times that the students quit because he cannot. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, when I talk to them, when they quit, it's very rare. But the common is the relationship with the parents. So we are deep in the psychology here with parenting and the society around and the valorization of the children.
Right.
So it's a kind of maltraitance. How do you say that in English?
Je sais pas le mot maltraitance, I don't know what that is.
Maltreatment. Maltreatment.
Okay. Children. Right. Well, I was thinking about one of the main obstacles in my mind in the time that I've worked with you, that I've had to fight on occasion, ego. where I've noticed that in other people too, that oftentimes I feel like, oh, I've got all these years of training, I can do this my way. And I'm confronted with the fact that it's inadequate. If I actually want to be able to make a breakthrough beyond a certain point, I'm not able to hold on to my way anymore. And that internally has been a conflict. I've seen this in other people as well. And I think that many times, especially in painting, we want to just go and express ourselves. We want to just do what we want to do. And I think that sometimes people maybe fall off of your program.
That's a good
because they don't feel comment. Like they're able to express themselves at their pace, and they have to take the time and discover what they don't know.
Yeah.
Would you say that that's also a
This is very interesting, because the most important thing in that kind of situation is for the person is to understand the principles. The principles are superior to any kind of talent. So the people mixed up. And then they succeed when they understand it's a matter of principle, not a matter of personal. So you have to understand that the system that I bring here, it's not my system. It's the natural law system by principles. And as soon as the person understands that she or he needs to grasp the principles, it's not personal. And then the ego understands. It's not a menace, it's not a threat. It's a matter of passing through the struggle to understand the principles.
Okay, so before we end, I'd like to just ask one last question, and then we can wrap up this little video. Obviously, looking around us, I know we're two very politically aware people, and looking at our culture, looking at our world situation, it does seem like a lot of the philosophical ideas that have been dominant over the course of our lifetimes, the geopolitical, the ethical, a lot of the ideas that have governed our Western civilization are being put into question. And I'm seeing that there's more criticism of postmodernism. You have figures like Cesar Santos, we've spoken about. There are other organizations that are trying to revive classical techniques in poetry. There's organizations that are doing the same for painting and for also classical music. And there's a certain recognition that this cult of ugliness, which has really dominated the establishment of the arts for many decades, is it doesn't have enough to endure. You brought up the example of natural law, that it defies natural law. It's a, you know, and that people don't really like contemporary arts. Like when you ask people honestly in a contemporary arts museum, what did you feel by looking at this giant canvas with a little black dot? The idea that this is genuinely inspiring them isn't very much present. If anything, it's an intellectual exercise that they try to come up with. But when you compare it to somebody who's looking at a Rembrandt or something by Da Vinci, there's you have to be a pretty dead, numb soul to say this is not moving me, this is not beautiful. It speaks more directly to the heart. What would you say that the role of the artist should be in the coming decades as society continues to break free of these institutions and traditions of irrationalism, and recapture these lost techniques of classical aesthetics, classical beauty? How do you think artists should think about that?
It's a mission. It's a mission, totally a mission, to bring back beauty in order to inspire people to reproduce beauty in their lives. That's the simple way to explain that. Right now. But and classical culture, it's for the future. So it's not the same thinking. Because if you bring classical culture, classical beauty, and natural law, you will plan for a future, but not right now. It's a building process, and it will bring happiness, because you built something good for the others. And that's the principle of the Renaissance, bringing the good for the others in creativity.
Right.
And in the fine art, like I said a few minutes ago, it's a cognitive process.
Right.
It's the same cognitive process to understand scientific equation.
Right.
The same.
And in that sense, you brought up population, you brought up natural law, you brought up beauty, and I think that when you look at a lot of these population growth charts over the last 1,000 years, there's an incredible spike with the Renaissance period of the 15th century, right?
The Renaissance.
And if you think about what happened there, was it what caused population to grow like that? Is it just all of a sudden we decided to not be in a dark age? And it's like, well, no. When you get down to it, you had the teaching of orphans, how to read, how to transcribe classics. You had people like Da Vinci, who was not born into a noble family, but who was given all of the skills as an engineer, as well as an artist, right, and an architect, to find within themselves their higher potentials. And that became something institutionalized. So the idea of a Renaissance, a rebirth, really, I think, I like the fact that you've touched on that. That's a very important idea.
And, it's the case of the fight that we are in nowadays. Mm. And we are in the crossroad nowadays. And I think it's important to bring back the philosophy and the thinking of the Renaissance.
Beautiful. I think that's a great way to end. And if people watching this video would like to know more about your paintings, would like to even commission you for a painting of a portrait of something, I know we have an example of your wife and your child behind that's a work in progress. How could they do that?
What?
How could people reach you and see more examples of your paintings or reach out to you?
Okay, ben, sirpatrick.com.
Sirpatrick.com. How do you spell that?
C-Y-R Patrick with the .com, yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you, Patrick. And till next time, we're going to continue our series of Rising Tide videos with more lectures in the weeks ahead.